Today we celebrate the third Sunday of Easter. Thank you for joining us in our worship. Please keep in prayer those who are sick, including Carlotta Lucero and Chip Brigant. Please also remember those who have died. Today's Mass is offered for David Graham. Please stand.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death, but God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. children, I am writing this to you so that you may not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. The way we may be sure that we know him is to keep his commandments. Those who say, I know him, but do not keep his commandments, are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
Recently watching a Diamondback game, and I saw this advertisement that kind of ends with this phrase that comes across the screen. It says, he gets us. It's a Jesus commercial. Maybe you've seen it before. It's like they kind of show someone suffering, and then there's an act of compassion, and then it kind of just says, he gets us. And I was thinking about it. I was like, oh, that's kind of interesting. I mean, because it's actually like not the whole story. I mean, what they say is true and nice and everything. It's like he does get us. That's important for us to know, to acknowledge. But really, the other side of that is like, do we get him? You know, it's one thing to say like, yeah, Jesus gets us, and sometimes we use it as an excuse or a cop-out in our lives if we sin or something, and we're like, well, Jesus gets me, you know, and it's like, you know, Jesus understanding us is never the problem, you know, the problem is more so, do we understand him, do we know him, and I think about it as we look at our readings for this third Sunday of Easter, as we disciples. And at the end, he says, he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. Thus it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name. And Jesus said, I'm going to suffer, die, rise, but then your part is repentance. Your part is asking for forgiveness of sins. Jesus, he gets us, but do we get what he's saying to us? Do we understand that Jesus in his passion, death, and resurrection is then inviting each of us to conversion? Not just to make excuses for our lives or these things, but to say, no, Lord, I desire to be converted back to you. And Jesus says, it's written that the Christ would suffer, rise from the dead on the third day. And we hear it at various places earlier in the Gospels where Jesus tells his disciples, the Son of Man must suffer greatly, must be persecuted by the scribes, the Pharisees, the chief priests, but on the third day rise. And the Gospel writers will often tell us afterwards, the disciples pondered what rising from the dead meant. What did that mean? And when Jesus rises from the dead, what is he doing? But once more, he's giving himself to us. In any relationship, it's going to go both ways. He gives himself to us, but if we don't give ourselves back to him, then what is it? If we only give ourselves a little bit, if we only give a little bit of ourselves to him, then he can't redeem all of us. But he gives himself entirely. He does rise from the dead. He says, why are you troubled? Why do questions arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. It's me. He says, touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones, as you can see I have. The Lord, this startling thing where he says, flesh and bones. This great corporality of the resurrection. I think in one way, when you're hungry and you smell something really good, and you're like, I actually feel hungrier now, the smell can't satisfy. You actually need the substance. You need something to consume. Jesus appearing as a ghost, that's whatever. But that's not what he does. Jesus says, no, I come in flesh and blood. I come to give myself to you, to show you the redemption I desire to offer to you. He says, touch me and see. I think it's St. Ambrose who says that Jesus' glorified body is able to pass through walls, come into these locked places, but because he's entirely living in union with his soul. The body and soul aren't experiencing conflict, but it's all ordered to the Heavenly Father. That's what Jesus desires to do, to redeem us, to bring us closer to himself. But it means that we give ourselves to him as he asks for us. We don't make excuses. We don't just say, Jesus gets me. Jesus understands. It's he does. But that's not the end of the story. Jesus wants more. We hear so often in the Old Testament God saying, am I not a jealous God? Well, what is God jealous for, of course, but each and every one of us entirely. Jealous for our whole being, because he desires for us to live with him. But for us, in the resurrection, Jesus is preaching that repentance, forgiveness of sins. And so what is it in my life that I need to repent of? What is it that I need to ask forgiveness of sins for? And if we can't ask Jesus for forgiveness, if we can't ask him to redeem anything in our lives, then we'll be living without a Savior. We'll be living without a Redeemer. But Jesus wants to redeem, wants to give himself to us, wants us to experience deeper freedom in this life so that we can know him. And it's difficult sometimes to offer ourselves to the Lord. It's difficult sometimes to say, do I really need to be really vulnerable? Do I really need to repent of everything or ask forgiveness for these things that I'm trying to forget about way in my past, It's we do need that. I think about when I was a kid and I'd scrape my knee or my elbow or something, and what happens when you do that? Mom comes with that threatening brown that rhymes with, like, this is going to hurt a little bit, but it's actually better if it hurts a little bit right now so that you can heal more completely. And it's easy to forget about that in our lives. Because we think, like, no, I don't need to suffer. I'm like, you know, Jesus came and we're good. We're good. But it's like, no, actually, the Lord knows that sometimes we need to suffer. We need to suffer so that we can experience greater freedom. And it's difficult. It's difficult to be able to, like, admit to ourselves sometimes the places that we've sinned in our lives, the places that we've been. And we're like, man, if I could just, like, forget about these things, maybe God will forget about them too. And it's like, tell me how that's working out for you. You know? But the Lord wants to heal. He wants to heal each of us. He wants to bring us to life. It's kind of like I mentioned last week, and that when the Lord appears with his wounds, what he's saying is, like, he's saying, I'm taking my woundedness with me into heaven. My woundedness becomes a sign of hope for each and every one of you, for each and every one of us. Just desiring to redeem. And the Lord heals as much as we show him. He heals as much as we show him. But if we don't show him, it can't be healed. And the Father wants us to be healed, to offer ourselves, to offer repentance, to ask for forgiveness of sins. You know, one of the things I find so beautiful about the RCIA, the way that people come into the church, is that it actually says in the rite that those who are coming into the church need to express repentance for their past way of life. You know, sometimes we're like, if someone wants to come to the church, we're like, oh yeah, you're good, Jesus gets it, Jesus, just come on in. It's like, no, like, there actually needs to be a holistic conversion and turning to the Lord. And it's not just for those who are coming into the church, it's for all of us. To always be saying, okay, Lord, here's where I've fallen short. Here's where I've tried to go about things my own way. But you are the way. You are the truth. You are the life. And the more that we can surrender ourselves to the Lord, the more that we can live a deeper and authentic communion with him. And in living in that communion, we can also live what we hear in our first reading, what we hear at the end of the gospel today. Jesus says, you are witnesses of these things. Okay, where is the Lord inviting us to give witness? Think about when the apostles had to choose a replacement for Judas among their number. One of the criteria was that the person had to be a witness to the resurrection. That they had to be able to say, yeah, I saw his flesh and bones. I saw it. He actually invited me to touch it. He invited me to touch the wounds. And I can tell you, because I myself touched this finger, touched the wounds. Yeah, that's kind of one of the reasons that one of the relics that the church has is a finger of Thomas the Apostle. You can actually see the finger of Thomas the Apostle and say, that's the finger that touched the wounds. Well, one of my favorite parts of the tour of the catacombs underneath St. Peter's Basilica is the tour ends getting as close as you can to the bones of St. Peter. And I remember my tour guide saying, like, as we came to the bones of St. Peter, he said, we are now as close as you can get to the bones that walked on water. To the bones that walked on water. To the bones that said, come to me. Come. You know, if you think about those apostles, they said, no, we're witnesses. We saw it. How does John begin his first letter? He says, what we have seen, what we have heard, what our hands have touched, the word of life. And you and I, we too are witnesses of those things. And because Jesus Christ becomes present in the Eucharist, he becomes present, he comes close to us, desiring to redeem us. Always coming, always drawing close, but always waiting for our response. And so, will we ask ourselves this week, do I get Jesus? Do I understand the one who comes to me? And do I understand him as he gives himself to me? Not as I try to create him in my head, but as he gives himself to me, inviting me to deeper repentance, inviting me to receive the forgiveness of sins. And am I willing to be a witness of that love? The witness of the resurrection, to be able to tell those around me, yeah, he becomes present in the flesh and blood in the Eucharist. He invites me to touch him, to receive him, that he may become part of me, that I may become a part of him. And maybe part of the his resurrection. I'd like to invite our catechumens to please come forward. Dear friends, this community now sends you forth to reflect more deeply upon the Word of God which you have shared with us today. Be assured of our loving support and prayers for you. We look forward to the day when you will share fully in the Lord's table. Please rise. I believe in one God. Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified. He suffered death and was buried. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. As we hear Christ's word, our hearts burn within us, longing for God's presence. With Easter hope, we bring our needs to the Father.
That those who teach in the church will remain faithful to the gospel of repentance and forgiveness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That leaders of the church, government, and industry will work together to provide food, employment, and justice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For increased vocations to the priesthood and religious life, especially from our own families in this parish. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are dying may know the peace of the risen Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all of us here, with our loved ones, someday share in glorious life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Almighty God and Father, we ask you to grant these prayers through your risen Son, the glorious Prince of Life, living and reigning forever and ever. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow your love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is the giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Come true to the Lord. thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, in recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Francis and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and John, our Bishop, Eduardo, his assistant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you've gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom we have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Thank you.
Praise God, your nature, the king's praise.
ordination to the priesthood or religious life. Members of this group will be in the narthex after Mass to answer questions, pass out prayer cards. If you are interested in joining this group, please stop by the table in the back. One of the things that the Mothers of Lou will be doing is having a monthly holy hour to pray for vocations, and the first one will be tomorrow evening here in the church, I believe at 6 p.m. And then there are coffee, donuts, and fellowship in the school gym after Mass. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace, glorify the Lord with your life.
Thanks be to God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Resurrection Day. We celebrate your resurrection day.